These sequences of letters are a kind of recipe. They're deceptively simple, but in fact, they may be the most complex instructions on our planet. They form the genetic code that specifies the characteristics of all living organisms and are central to our understanding of life on Earth. These letters represent the nitrogen bases of deoxyribonucleic acid, or DNA. In recent years, DNA has become the focus of intense scientific and commercial research. But the search for the genetic code has been underway ever since the principles of heredity were formulated. By the turn of the 20th century, scientists began to realize that tiny fragments of matter, called chromosomes, contain enormous amounts of complex information. It would take creative thinking and concerted laboratory study over many years to finally establish the fundamental genetic ingredient, DNA. Over 100 years ago, the Swiss chemist Friedrich Miescher isolated this amazing molecule, deoxyribonucleic acid, or DNA. But it took many scientists over a period of 80 years to conclude that DNA is the genetic material. In this program, we'll follow the history of events that led to the discovery of the structure of DNA. Models will be used to demonstrate that structure and the base sequence of DNA. And you'll see how a cell can be transformed when a new segment of DNA is introduced into its genome. By the end of the program, you'll realize the importance of remaining open-minded towards new scientific research. And you'll appreciate that learning new concepts requires knowledge, skill, and a certain degree of risk-taking.
We're going to take a little trip into the past and learn how the discovery of DNA as the genetic material came about. Scientists knew for a very long time that chromosomes contained protein and DNA. Bearing this in mind, we can begin solving the puzzle. And the first piece takes us back to Friedrich Miescher in the 1870s. He was the first to isolate DNA. He believed that by solving the mystery of nuclear composition, a window would be opened and we could see the mysteries of life. The only problem was, at the time he isolated DNA, scientists believed that proteins carried the genetic information. Nobody paid very much attention to his discovery.
Why did they choose proteins as the genetic material?
What I'm putting down on the table right now are the abbreviations for the 20 different amino acids. It was known at that time that proteins are made up of these amino acids in various combinations. DNA only has 4 nucleotides. So it appeared to be too simple a molecule to carry all the genetic material for variation in species, even individual differences within a species. Not everyone believed that protein was the genetic material, which brings us back to the puzzle. And a second piece, Frederick Griffith.
I read about Frederick Griffith. He was really important, but I can't remember why.
Frederick Griffith was a bacteriologist working in England in 1928. He was trying to produce a vaccine against pneumonia. He experimented with 2 different strains of the bacterium Streptococcus pneumoniae. Let's take a look at his experiment. Frederick Griffith used 2 strains of the bacterium Streptococcus pneumoniae, an encapsulated strain which causes pneumonia, and a non-encapsulated strain which does not cause pneumonia. The capsule protects the bacterium from the immune system of the invaded organism. When he injected 1 group of mice with encapsulated bacteria, they contracted pneumonia and died. Griffith took blood samples from the dead mice and found live encapsulated bacteria in the samples. He injected a 2nd group with non-encapsulated bacteria, which produced no infection, and the mice lived.
Their blood samples revealed no live bacteria. Then a third group was injected with encapsulated bacteria that had been heat-killed. In this case, the mice also survived. The application of heat had apparently weakened the virulence, or the pneumonia-causing capacity of the encapsulated bacteria. However, when a fourth group was injected with a mixture of heat-killed encapsulated bacteria and live non-encapsulated bacteria, the mice died. Individually, the heat-killed encapsulated bacteria and the live non-encapsulated bacteria would not infect the mice, but in combination, they killed the animals. Blood samples from these mice revealed live encapsulated bacteria in the mice. So what conclusions do you think Griffith made from these results?
Well, there may have been something still present in the non-encapsulated bacteria which caused the infection, even though the encapsulated bacteria were heat-killed.
And the bacteria was killed, because in this one the mouse is still alive. But the mouse that was infected with the non-heat-killed encapsulated bacteria is quite dead.
Yes, but the non-encapsulated bacteria was alive, so therefore it may have been able to acquire the ability to cause the infection. Even though the heat-killed bacteria were dead, the genetic material that can cause pneumonia may have still been functional, and it therefore was passed on to the live bacteria that infected the mice.
Great deduction, Benez. The principle of living organisms incorporating extracellular DNA into their genome is called transformation.
But we still haven't answered the question as to whether protein or DNA is the genetic material.
You're right, Cam. But it set the stage for another experiment. That brings us back to the puzzle and the third piece. Go to the year 1944.
This piece of the puzzle features three men: Oswald Avery, Colin MacLeod, and Macklin McCarty.
Right. These three scientists built on the work of Griffith. Their experiment was to determine the chemical nature of the genetic material that caused the change in the non-encapsulated bacteria in the Griffith experiment. First, they separated heat-killed encapsulated bacteria into the component parts: carbohydrates, lipids, proteins, DNA, and RNA. Let's go to the table and we'll simulate their experiment. Okay. Here is a heat-killed encapsulated bacterium. I'll just cut this up into its component parts. While I'm doing that, Benaz, if you could put these labels in the test tubes. And Cam, why don't you clear away Griffith's experiment? You can bring the other mouse in because we'll need five mice. Thanks. Good. So, they had five test tubes, one with RNA, lipids, carbohydrates, proteins, and DNA. Then what did they do?
Well, they were looking for the component that was the genetic information that caused the bacteria to transform. So each of the components would have to be cultured with non-encapsulating bacteria.
Okay, here's some little cutouts, Benaz. You culture our test tubes for us? That's exactly what they did do. What was the next step?
I guess they would have injected the mice with each bacterial culture.
And knowing what you know about genetic material, what do you predict the results would be?
Well, I know DNA is the genetic material, so the only mice to get sick would be the ones who were injected with the bacteria that was cultured with DNA from the heat-killed encapsulated bacteria.
Show me if these are the labels that represent each of the component test tubes. Excellent. And even though these were convincing results that supported DNA as the genetic material, they did other experiments.
Like what?
Well, let me clear away this. We're still using the components of heat-killed encapsulated bacteria. So I'll use these again. And Benaz, can you recollect the non-encapsulated bacteria? Great.
But what they did was they combined all the components. RNA, proteins, carbohydrates, lipids, DNA. Put them into a sample. Then they took from this test tube a sample and filled each of the five test tubes with a collection. Then they took enzymes, an enzyme which broke down carbohydrates, and injected it in the first tube. This blue paper represents an enzyme which breaks down lipids. The green paper represents protein digesting enzyme. The orange is DNA digesting enzyme. And the last test tube had RNA digesting enzyme added to it. Then what do you suppose they did?
Well, they cultured each mixture with a non-encapsulated bacteria and then injected the mice.
Exactly. Can you do the honors for us?
Let me guess the results. The only mouse to survive would be the one who was injected with the culture containing the DNA-destroying enzyme. The rest would probably get sick and die.
So if we let these labels represent the enzymes that were added to the test tubes, what would the results be? Absolutely. What can we interpret from these results?
Well, the results confirm that DNA is the genetic material.
And only when DNA is present does the non-encapsulated bacteria transform into the infectious encapsulated strain.
So were scientists finally convinced that DNA, not proteins, were the genetic material?
There were still skeptics who believed that DNA was too simple a molecule, and that proteins, being more complicated, were the logical choice for the genetic material. In 1952, there was another experiment that shed new light on the DNA puzzle. It's time for piece number four. Alfred Hershey and Martha Chase did an experiment that finally led to the acceptance of DNA as the genetic material. Before we go into their study, we need to discuss viruses and radioactive tracers.
I know about viruses. They cause diseases, like the common cold.
And they're very small.
You're both right. There are many viruses. The one thing that they all have in common is that they need a host in order to reproduce. The virus we're going to look at is called a bacteriophage.
A bacteria eater.
Right. You know your Latin. It's called a bacteriophage because it infects bacteria. So if this is our bacterium, and this is the phage. Now, the bacteriophage consists of a protein coat enclosing a single strand of DNA.
Well, viruses are literally pretty simple. So, what are radioactive tracers?
Radioactive tracers are radioactive isotopes of certain elements whose pathways are very easy to follow. Hershey and Chase worked with a bacteriophage consisting of DNA encased in a protein coat. They were able to radioactively label and distinguish two separate samples of the virus by using radioactive tracers. Protein coat of one culture of the virus was labeled using radioactive sulfur, and the DNA in the other culture was labeled with radioactive phosphorus. Sulfur is found in protein but not in DNA. Similarly, phosphorus is a constituent of DNA, but not protein. The labeled bacteriophages were then mixed with bacteria. Later analysis of the infected bacteria showed that the radioactive sulfur had remained outside the bacterial cells, in the protein of the viral coats. However, there was radioactive phosphorus present inside the bacterial cells. The bacterium containing the viral DNA will produce complete viral particles that are identical to the original bacteriophage. What conclusions can you draw from these results?
Well, the radioactive phosphorus must have entered the infective bacteria with the viral DNA, which was labeled with the phosphorus. The genetic material for the virus is DNA and not protein.
which agrees with the results from the radioactive sulfur, which showed that the radioactivity was located in the protein coat of the virus outside the bacterium.
Right. Now, after this experiment, DNA was widely accepted as the genetic material. There was still the question of its structure. Many scientists believed DNA was too simplistic a molecule to code for the complexities of life. So they set about trying to unravel the molecular structure of DNA. That brings us back to the puzzle. Piece number 5.
Back to the 1920s and the experiments of P.A. Levine.
P.A. Levine? Did he work with mice as well?
Actually, P.A. Levine was a renowned biochemist. And he showed that DNA could be broken down into 4 nitrogen bases. Adenine, guanine, thymine, and cytosine, a 5-carbon sugar, and a phosphate group. Based on the proportions of these components, Levine made 2 deductions, one of which was correct and one of which was incorrect. The first deduction he made was that each nitrogen base was attached to a molecule of sugar, and that in turn was attached to a phosphate group. This would form a single molecule, which he called a nucleotide.
That was the correct deduction, right?
Yes. Second deduction he made was based on his measurements. In every sample he measured, the proportions of the nitrogen bases were approximately the same. So he concluded what?
That all 4 nitrogen bases must be present in DNA in equal quantities.
It seemed logical at the time. Levine hypothesized that these molecules would be clustered in groups of 4. Tetranucleotides, and that these molecules would be strung out along the DNA molecule over and over and over, one after the other. Even though this hypothesis was incorrect, it dominated scientific thinking for over a decade. Until 1947, when Erwin Chargaff did his research on the base composition of DNA, Chargaff discovered that DNA is species-specific. When the DNA from any organism is sampled, the measurements of the proportions of the nitrogenous bases will always be the same within a species, but that proportion, or ratio of the bases, will vary among species. Take a look at this chart. Tell me what you see. Compares the percentages of the purines, adenine and guanine, and the pyrimidines, cytosine and thymine, from a variety of sample species.
It appears that the percentages of guanine and cytosine are just about the same for all of them.
Right, and the percent content of adenine is the same as that for thymine.
Right. Chargaff also noted that cells from individuals of a species will always have the same proportion of bases, but that individuals from other species will have different ratios.
So any ox would have an adenine percent of 29 or a guanine percent of 21.2? That will change for other species?
Absolutely.
So the variation in base composition could be the clue to the different genetic instructions for different species?
Do you see? DNA is not so simple a molecule as was first believed. By the time Chargaff's work was published, most of the scientific community was convinced that DNA was the genetic material. The only question remaining was, what was its molecular structure?
I think that leads us to the next piece of the puzzle.
And here it is. It deals with the X-ray crystallography of DNA.
That was the work of Rosalind Franklin and Maurice Wilkins, and they were working on the molecular structure of DNA. Their techniques were very complicated, but I think I can simplify them. They crystallized a molecule of DNA, then fired X-rays at that molecule. They captured the pattern of scattering of those X-rays on photographic film. It's called X-ray diffraction photography, and it revealed that the molecular structure of DNA was helical, that spiral staircase that we're all so familiar with now.
I'm not sure I quite grasp this process of X-ray diffraction.
Well, let's take a closer look at that technology and some new techniques that are being used to study DNA.
X-ray crystallography has been around for quite a number of years, and in those machines they use a special source, the metal, usually a copper source, to generate X-rays. And then the next thing they need is they need a crystal of the material that they're interested in. Then they can take this beam of X-rays and direct it at the crystal, and that will then diffract the X-rays all over the place. And if the crystal is well ordered, you will get spots at very specific locations. And those spots actually contain information about how the atoms are arranged in three-dimensional space. But the X-ray crystallographers can from this conclude completely what the three-dimensional structure of the DNA looks like. The most powerful technology that has come forward, particularly over the last 20 years, is a technique called nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. And we're sitting here right in front of a state-of-the-art NMR spectrometer. NMR allows you a more dynamic picture of the molecule than X-ray does. In X-ray, you sort of freeze your molecule into one fixed conformation into that crystal, and that's what you can determine. By NMR, we can actually look at changes in the structure as they occur. For example, when you raise the temperature, DNA will melt. We can also add other molecules into the solution. One of the things that is very interesting, of course, is the addition of drugs. We can then see where a drug would go and sit on the DNA. Another application of this technology is to look at the binding of proteins to DNA. As you know, DNA is not just naked. It is usually dotted with a lot of proteins that sit in the major groove of the DNA primarily. And as they sit there, they regulate what parts of the DNA are being transcribed and later on translated. We can look at how these proteins and these DNA pieces get together, and we can do that again in all kinds of different solvent conditions in order to mimic what's happening inside the cell.
The final piece of the puzzle. This piece features the work of James Watson and Francis Crick. So this is what DNA really looks like.
Watson and Crick proposed this model after they had analyzed all the data from the sources that we've been discussing. The most important sets of data were from Chargaff for the proportion of nitrogen bases and Franklin and Wilkins in their X-ray crystallography of DNA. From the X-ray data, they hypothesized that DNA was a double-stranded helix, that is, each strand coiling around the other. They measured the radius of the helix, and they determined that the only way to maintain a consistent radius through the whole length of DNA was if adenine paired with thymine and cytosine paired with guanine. Those pairings occupy the same radial space. No other linkages would work.
Chargaff's data showed that the percentages of thymine and adenine were about the same, as well as guanine and cytosine.
Exactly. The Watson and Crick model shows that those complementary pairs have complementary shapes, and that's how they can maintain the consistent radius.
This puzzle diagram is similar to that of this model. They both have the similar double-strand DNA helix structure.
Good work, Benaz and Cam. DNA is composed of a phosphate, a 5-carbon sugar called deoxyribose, and 4 kinds of nitrogen bases. Adenine and guanine are double-ringed structures that belong to a group called purines. Thymine and cytosine belong to the pyrimidine group and have only one ring. These components of DNA are arranged in units called nucleotides. Each nucleotide consists of a nitrogen base attached to a deoxyribose and a phosphate. Each nucleotide has sites available for bonding with other nucleotides. Many nucleotides bonded together form a polynucleotide. The DNA molecule consists of 2 strands of nucleotides held together by the pairing of nitrogen bases. Adenine pairs with thymine, and guanine with cytosine. The 2 strands are wound around a common axis, forming a double helix. What do you notice when I untwist this double helix?
It looks like a ladder.
Exactly. You and Benaz are going to build your own straight ladder versions of a DNA molecule. It's very easy. Just write a vertical sequence of nucleotides on one side, and beside them, write the complementary bases. We'll compare our results later. They look almost the same. But are they?
There's a difference in the sequence of base pairs.
Good observation, Cam. You notice that both of you have done excellent DNA models.
but the sequencing of your nucleotides is different. That's because there's no restriction on the order of the bases in DNA, except that the proportion of the bases needs to be consistent with the species. How does this account for the diversity among species?
The variation in the sequence of bases seems to be the key in storing genetic information. In my readings, I learned that the sequence of portions of DNA strands may be identical. For example, the same protein can be produced in a flowering plant and in a bird. So, the sequence that codes for that protein can be found on the DNA strand of each organism. However, the overall sequence of the DNA molecule in a plant will be different than the sequence of DNA in a bird.
Well, one of the things that's being revealed by all of this DNA sequence information that's flooding in is the amazing unity of all the living organisms on the Earth. I think that there are a lot of scientists who are surprised at how similar many of our enzymes are turning out to be, many of our proteins and our enzymes in general, to bacterial forms, for example.
Now, do you remember the transforming of the encapsulated bacteria and the non-encapsulating bacteria we observed in Griffith's experiments?
Yes.
Well, how did the non-encapsulated bacteria become encapsulated?
The DNA from the encapsulated bacteria somehow became incorporated into the DNA of the non-encapsulated bacteria.
The DNA sequence of the non-encapsulated bacteria was altered, and as a result of that alteration, the non-encapsulated bacteria was able to produce a capsule.
Right. In later programs, you'll learn how scientists can manipulate DNA in various processes, called genetic engineering.
Genetic engineering is the science and applied technology of manipulating the genetic code. Genetic engineers are now able to insert human genes into bacteria. These bacteria are then used to produce a human protein. Two examples of such proteins are synthetic hormone insulin and human growth hormone. Today, most insulin-dependent diabetics use human insulin that is produced by bacteria.
What are the main points that you remember from learning the discovery of DNA?
Well, I've learned that it's critical to keep an open mind and to always search for a complete explanation.
Right. The understanding of DNA and how it works progressed because scientists explored and tested out new hypotheses.
And new technologies.
They also followed methods of scientific investigations.
Do you understand how this all fits together?
Yes.
So a long line of creative scientific minds using carefully conducted experiments have brought us this far. But we know there's a lot more to learn, especially about the genetic code and the potential that it holds for our future.